Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Eric Walker, and welcome to this edition of Revealing Prophecy. In the past, we've shared news stories with you. However, I want to encourage you to begin your own search for the prophetically important stories of the day by expanding your own set of reliable sources. Many of our featured guests, such as Carl Gallups, Rabbi Zev Perot, Dr. Michael Heiser, Dr. Michael Lake, Dr. Jeff Johnson, Joe Newby, and more, all have a wealth of resources available for you to research. Read the Middle East news feeds and find trusted journalists who have their finger on the pulse of the prophetic as it unfolds around the world. We encourage you to visit IgnitiaNation.com for a full roster of live daily interviews and check out the Biblical Truth Library containing over 1,000 hours of rich Bible teachings. Download our new apps and subscribe to the Igniting Nation YouTube channel, Apple TV, Roku, Android TV, and Amazon Fire channels to watch our great lineup of guest interviews. And now for today's monologue. Few would argue that we are in the midst of unprecedented times. I can't remember a time when I've heard and seen so much focusing on the catching away and the timing of the 70th week of Daniel. I began to think back to how many generations of the Bible faced the brink of disaster, and especially my people, the Jews. It seems it always came down to one person appointed by God to bring about our redemption. It was the obedience and faith of one man, Abraham, who secured the lineage that would lead to the birth of Messiah, as he was willing to sacrifice his only son. When Joseph, one man, called for his family to join him in Egypt, there were only 70 left in the line of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. If that is not on the brink of extinction, then I don't know how much lower the number would have to go. I'm reminded of how many times we have read about construction projects or pipelines that had to be rerouted to avoid wiping out an endangered species, and their numbers were greater than this. I think about Moses, one man appointed by God to lead the nation of Israel out of 400 years of slavery. I think about Rahab, one chosen by God to hide the spies at the risk of her own life to spare the children of Israel. If I think back to the edict that Haman had ordered across all 127 provinces of the Persian Empire, where all the Jews lived, ordering the death of all of them, and it came down to one person, Esther, whose intercession spared the lives of the Jewish population. I think about God's messenger, Gabriel, speaking to both Joseph and Mary about the child that would be born, and the one man, Herod, intent on killing all the boys 2 years old and younger, hoping that he could stop God's son from becoming our atonement and redemption for sin. To all those generations, the end was so very near to them, yet the plans of God could not be stopped. Siege after siege over the course of thousands of years had seen the destruction of the first temple and the Babylonian exile. 70 years in exile only to return to find the walls and a heap of rubble. To all of them, they lived in their own definition of tribulation. What must it have felt like at the time of Jesus when Jerusalem was under the heavy yoke of Rome? And after his crucifixion, death, and resurrection, he departed after 40 days and sent the Holy Spirit. Yet Rome prevailed and the second temple was destroyed in 70 AD. The small band of rebels were defeated, and in 200 short years, Jewish worship had to be held in secret. To them, there could be no greater time of tribulation. The subsequent rise of the Emperor Constantine set in motion 1,700 years of Jewish persecution that included the Crusades and the Spanish Inquisition. The rise of Islam brought an even darker threat of annihilation still being preached in mosques all over the world, even today. And then the Holocaust and the slaughter of 6 million Jews. To the Jewish world, this was tribulation of biblical proportion. One third of our population killed over a period of 6 years. All these were signs of the times, and yet in the 70s we saw revival break out and Jewish people coming to faith in Jesus. To the traditional Jewish world, this was and is being perceived as a spiritual Holocaust. Certainly both biblical and world history is filled with tumultuous times that fall into the category of tribulation. That begs the question, is the tribulation we are seeing today more aligned with biblical prophecy? And is it an actual sign of the rise of the Antichrist? But rather than try and apply specific scriptures that allude to the last days, I want to focus this commentary on just one day, today. This is actually more in line with the message of the Bible than investing in trying to make sense of fitting current events into a biblical narrative. The question I believe God is asking, and where He has always directed our attention, is not what is to come, but what are we supposed to be doing today? I'm in no way implying that mine or anyone else's study and interest in connecting the dots of current events into a biblical narrative is in any way wrong or should not be pursued. But what I am saying, it has become a distraction from what we are called to do today. I believe we are in a season of self-examination and reflection and are being called to answer the question, what have you done to advance the kingdom today? When was the last time you shared the gospel? When was the last time you stopped and rendered aid or support to someone in need? When was the last time you felt that you were exemplifying the attributes of a follower of Messiah, even in the face of all the pandemic and pandemonium surrounding you? Are you checking on your older neighbors that may be in need of help? I am honestly appalled at some of the posts I've seen using language on becoming of a believer. Social media has become a bashing ground that makes it hard to discern who is a believer and who is not. The election has so polarized the nation that we have forgotten that the legalization of abortion is now 50 years old, and we have national figures espousing their faith at the same time they're legislating infanticide. The legalization of sex with minors, and not only supporting the cause of the LGBTQ+ agenda, but advocating for it all in the name of Messiah. Our youth are being indoctrinated into an alternative lifestyles, and because we as the body of Messiah have been virtually silent, this agenda has and will continue to advance. This is a today issue. And unfortunately, we have become so unfamiliar with the Word of God that we cannot defend our position on these matters that will lead up to the tomorrows that so many are speculating about. Prophecy is going to be fulfilled when God chooses to fulfill it. But it is our charge for today to be about the Father's work. Jesus Himself, who told us what it would be like in the last days, also told us not to concern ourselves with tomorrow, since today has enough trouble of its own. For many years, I have been an avid teacher and student of prophecy and have no plans to shelve that interest. But I want to challenge you to continue in the good work for which you are called, and that is the sharing of the gospel and the equipping of the saints. Several years ago, Tom Hanks was in a movie about the story of Gary Powers and the U-2 incident in the former Soviet Union. He played the role of a lawyer representing a Russian spy who was being used to negotiate a prisoner exchange. As they prepared many times to go before various legal and intelligence entities, Tom Hanks would ask the Russian spy if he was worried. The answer was always the same. Would it help? Whether you believe in a pre, mid, post, or whenever rapture, is there really anything you can do to make it happen the way you expect it to happen? The answer is clearly no. No one knows the day or the hour. So while we wait, what will we do with the time God is giving us? As I clearly conveyed, every generation has had their share of tribulation, and we are no different or special than they were. While they dealt with the present darkness and the troubles that surrounded them, they found their peace in God and then shared it with others. We are all familiar with the setting in the upper room in Acts chapter 2. While they were sheltered in place, they looked after one another and had fellowship together and studied the apostles' teachings, and God added to their numbers daily those being saved. For some, this is just a story in the Bible. And for others, it's a model of what we are to be doing each day. We are commanded to love the Lord our God with all our hearts and to love our neighbor as ourselves. We do not have to have the church doors open to stroll through our neighborhoods and talk to our neighbors. We do not need to be concerned about Halloween celebrations and decorations during the pandemic. We are all called to be ministers of reconciliation. We have the title, and God is looking to us today to be what we have been called to do. I want the Messiah to come back just as much as the next person. But until then, we are going to preach the word, broadcast sound biblical teaching, walk our neighborhoods and help our neighbors, and they shall know us by our fruit. You can be upset about how schools are being opened or closed, or you can step up to teach your children as God instructed us to do in Deuteronomy 6, 5 through 9. As for me and my house, we will, we must. It is not an option to serve the Lord because someone's eternal life depends on it. You are being called in this season, and the question is not when will the rapture take place, but when will you answer the call? And that, my friends, is this week's edition of Revealing Prophecy. This program, along with Revealing the Bible, are added every week to the Biblical Truth Library. Visit IgnitingNation.com and check out the Biblical Truth Library and our guest lineup of daily broadcasts of Revealing the Truth. Follow us online through Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube channel where you can catch up on over 1,800 interviews and never miss out on any of our great guests. Your comments and questions are always welcome, and you can use the contact form found on IgnitingNation.com. Don't forget our live broadcast are Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. Central Time. You can now watch a second channel on IgnitingNation.com/live to watch a 24-hour day, 7-day-a-week feed of some of our featured guests. Until we see you right back here for the next edition of Revealing the Truth, we thank you for watching and bless you with Shalom.